house of the Lord this morning, isn't it? It's absolutely wonderful to be in the house of the Lord. As we get started on this day, you know, every day should be a celebration day. We got even more reason to celebrate. You know, God's good to us. But I have to look over and say, after almost a year, I look over and I'm traveling to see you, Sister Nell. But Sister Nell Baldridge is here in church today. Wave everybody, Sister Nell. Able to be in the house of God. It's been since June of last year since she's able to be here. And aren't you glad? I mean, she looks so good. The other day, I went up there to see her, and she outwalked me from the cafeteria back to her room and everything. And so I had to check my steps and see how fast I was going. But Sister Camille, we're just so glad that you're able to be back. And she just looks like she's happy to be here, too. And so we ought to be all be happy to be here. And be sure to let her know that you got to see her and everything like that. And God is just good, isn't he? He's good to us. And I believe God has some special things. I want to mention to you a few things that we've got going, things that are going to be taking place. One, this evening at 5 o'clock, we're going to start back watching The Chosen. And got a special treat tonight. We're going to be having a taco bar. How many of you like tacos? We're going to have a taco bar here this evening. And so you can get some tacos and everything like that. And so we're going to have that. So it's going to be again this evening at 5 o'clock. And we have some other snacks if you've already ate by then and just want some snacks. And so there's some stuff left over. I have to tell the ladies, I have to apologize. Last week, I had promised the mothers that we would have those macaroons. And we went everywhere we could. And I found some macaroons, but they weren't those fancy ones. And so we went everywhere looking for macaroons. I mean, we went to Sam's, went to Walmart, went to Kroger, went to Hayes, went to every place you could, Jonesboro, Blyville, all those places. Nobody had them. Friday, I was in Sam's, and they had a big display of those macaroons. They didn't know that it was after Mother's Day, what have you. I didn't pick them up. I apologize for that, but I think the ladies still had a good food that they had for them last Sunday for Mother's Day. But I do apologize for you ladies for that. Also, want to remind you that on Tuesday, the 25th, from 1 to 5, we're going to be having a blood drive again here, Red Cross blood drive. So if you want to sign up, it's not on Wednesday this time, it's on Tuesday. And let me emphasize, we are in short supply of blood in our in America right now. They are constantly needing it. If somebody has to have surgery, they are really challenged if they've got blood to have if somebody needs blood. And so if you are a blood donor and able to give blood, please sign up. You sign up on the app, or you can let us know. You can let us know when you want to do that because we want to get people. I unfortunately cannot give blood this time because I gave a double donation last time, so I can't give until July. But again, we want you to be able to give, and we've got other people to give blood and let word out. If you can't do it, take the notification that we put on Facebook and share it so that other people can see that. Because it's not just us, it's a community blood drive is what it's for. We're hosting that here, and we're doing 6 of those this year because they need it. And furthermore, our hospital here uses Red Cross. So some of that blood could very well go and help somebody in need in our community if they need that. So again, want to just remind you of that and encourage you to participate by, if you can't get blood, by letting people know about it. We have some prayer needs that I want to ask that you remember in prayer. I'd ask that you continue to remember Sister Kathy Hopper in prayer. She needs a touch from God, and I know that God's going to give it to her, and Brother Walter as well. They have been through so much in these last couple of months, but just remember them in prayer. I know the last 6 weeks have just been very challenging for them, and so remember Sister Kathy, and I talked with her yesterday, and talked with Brother Walter yesterday. They need your prayers. Also, remember Sister Margie Flood in prayer. Miss Margie has been coming so very faithful. But she woke up this morning ill and needs prayer, so we want to remember her in prayer as well. I want to ask that you stand to your feet. We want to go begin this service with prayer, thanking these needs to the Lord, but also welcoming God in the house. How many of you want God to touch you today? How many of you believe God can touch you today? I believe He can. Heavenly Father, we love you today, and we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come into your house as always. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you and to magnify you and to glorify you, dear God. Lord, you are so good. Lord, we ask you, dear Lord, to hear our calls and cries unto you, dear Lord. Lord, that you would speak to us and speak into our spirit, dear God. Lord, we thank you, dear Lord, that you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. God, we pray that you would touch and minister, dear God, to these needs. We pray for Walter and Kathy, dear God. I pray for a miracle for them both, dear Lord, and I know that you're able to provide that. God, we pray that you would touch and minister, dear God, Lord, to Brother Hopper as well. I know he needs prayer and needs that touch as well, dear God. I pray that you touch Miss Margie, dear God, and that you give her healing and help her to recover quickly, dear Lord. God, we pray for each of these that are here, dear God, that you would minister to them in a very special way. God, we know that you are with us, dear God, and we know that you're going to touch us. We love you today. Would you lift up your hands right now? Would you welcome the Lord in the house? Would you honor him right now as we begin this time of worship and praise? Opportunity right now we can give in our tithe and in our offerings, and this is a special time. And as I was thinking about our giving, and one of the things that we get to do, there is a joy in giving. I said, there is a joy in giving. You know, to me, when we get to bring our tithe and get to bring our offerings and lay them in these buckets, it is a joyful thing. I think of it like planting seed. I think of it an opportunity of obedience and honoring God. But, you know, there's a lot of things in life that don't bring you joy. But giving is one of those things. Honoring God and tithe and offering is one of those things. Planting seed in the kingdom of God is one of those things that will bring you joy. So this morning, as we get ready to bring our tithe, and you get to drop them in these buckets, or you can put them in those buckets at the back of the pews, you can in any one of those things, we have an opportunity to let this bring joy into your life and excitement into your life. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the joy of being able to give, being able to bring our tithe and bring our offerings to you, dear God, to be able to glorify you and magnify you with it, dear God. I pray that everyone here would know the joy in giving, dear God. That blessed joy, dear God, of being able to follow you in obedience, dear God, and follow you in sacrifice. Thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you right now worship the Lord with your gifts?
Heaven comes to fight for me. Satisfied.
praise Him this morning. It's a great opportunity we have to worship the Lord. I'm going to let you be seated right now. Before we get into the message this morning, I've got something special that we want to do. Do things, everything we do things a little bit differently, and sometimes different things, and we have different opportunities to do things, and like I say, sometimes doing things a different way is not a bad way. So we're going to get ready, with just a moment here, we're going to honor some graduates before we get into the Word, and this, as you know, this is graduation season all around us, so what we're going to do is I want to show you a couple of videos of some graduates, and we're going to do it one at a time, so they each have their own video. So I'm going to ask Christian Allen, come up here. Christian is a graduate, just graduated yesterday from Valley View. Christian, if you would, come up here and sit on this front row for just a moment here. Mike, would you go ahead and put Christian's video up there?
All right, we're doing a tribute right now to Christian Allen on his getting ready to graduate from high school. And so we're going to start with his grandpa, Ricky.
Well, I'm glad to, you know, say something about Christian. He's a good man. He's always been, he was just a very straightforward kid. He would ask you questions, and I tell you, he'd ask me some tough questions sometimes. But he was always a loving guy. He always had a smile on his face, and he's grown up to be a really a good man, and I'm proud of him, and I love him very much. I'm proud to be his grandpa, and I thank the Lord for Christian and his brother Caleb as well, and his sister and all his mom. I just love him to death, and we want to be a blessing to him.
Well, what can I say about Christian? Is that I love him very much, and I'm glad I'm thankful for what he's turned out to be. He's a handsome, loving boy. Him and Caleb, I used to take him to the park when he was little, and it just, I just love him to death. And I don't know what else to say, but I'm just thankful for him and what he's become, and I know he's going to go far in life.
Taylor, this is your opportunity. Okay. You let your brother back.
What I like to say about my brother is I'm thankful that I have a brother and that God gave me a brother to help me through my life and always helped me in high school and all the way through school, helping me and even in life, just helping me advance. Having a big brother is always a blessing from God to have it. And I love him a lot and I'm really thankful for it.
Hi, I'm Christian's mom. I want to say I'm proud of him. We're ready to see him graduate high school. I love him, and I know he's going to go far in life and do good. And I'm proud of him, Christian. I love you.
Now, Christian, whether you want to give any kind of message to your family at the time when you get ready to graduate?
My family is amazing. I thank them for everything they do. I wouldn't be the person I am without them. I am very blessed that they always raised me up in the church. I came up in the church and they always kept me and make sure I knew who God was, and I'm very blessed for that, and I'm thankful for them. I'm very happy to be graduating, and God's really, really been with me throughout high school and getting it done, and I'm glad we made it to the end.
Awesome. You know your family's proud of you, but this church is proud of you as well.
Yes, sir. I'm very thankful for everyone. I have a very big support system with my family and the church, and I'm proud and I'm happy. Thank you.
What are you gonna do in life?
I'm still deciding, but I just know one thing: I'm gonna keep God with me in anything that I do. So
awesome. Bit differently. I'm going to ask Christian to come up here. We're going to pray for these guys at the end of service today, but we want to give this to Christian right here. If we're going to send somebody off, we want to send them with the Word of God. And Christian, so this is a Bible from your church here, and we just want to let you know how proud we are of you, even if you're a Blazer, man.
Thank you.
All right? And so even if you went to Valley View, give him a hand clap. Like I said, we're going to pray with these guys at the end here. We're going to do another one here right now, okay? So come on, Michael. Michael's going to come up here. Michael's going to be graduating in August. You sit down, Christian. Michael's going to be graduating in August with his master's degree, and we don't do this in August. We're doing it now. So this is by faith. Isn't that right, Mike? All right. Mike, you believe you're going to graduate. Go ahead and put his on, if you would.
All right, Sister Connie, we are right now going to share some things. Mike is getting ready to graduate with his master's degree this summer. And so we are going to let each of you share something about Mike. We're going to let Mike share something. So you can share something of appreciation about Michael.
Okay. Michael Allen may be a grandmother, and that's one of the biggest joys that I've had in my life is being a grandmother. He's made me proud from the first day. He's an overcomer. He's had many accomplishments. He never gives up. He's always got a smile, a good attitude, and he loves to spend time with his family. I think one of the things that I hold dearest is that he's right there with me for whatever I want to do. He's a fan. He's a Razorback fan. And we watch ball games together. We go to ball games together. And that's just a special time that we have together. And I'm so proud of him. He's overcome so many things, and he never gives up.
Awesome. All right, Kelly, you get to do the same thing. Or you can let him have it.
Michael Allen, I'm so proud of you and all you've achieved and accomplished. You're such an inspiration to me. You've always persevered through every challenge that's been thrown your way. Keep living your dream, son, and keep God first in everything you do. Now go make mama some money.
All right, well, there you go. You know, I said something to Michael Allen before, and we were on our way to camp. I think you were on our way back to camp. And he was talking about you, and I said, well, Mike, you always remember the first pancake don't turn out right. And he agreed with that, and then he thought about what that meant. So now you get to share your thoughts about Mike.
Well, Mike's always gotten on my last nerve, but I do love him. I love him so much. Me and him always like argue and stuff, but we're always there for each other. Like, if everyone needs food or something, he always goes to Taco Bell for me. Or if I ever forget something at home, he'll go and get it for me, even though I know I'm mean to him. But he still loves me, and I'm
back when I first met you guys, my brother Mike, he used to save his money really good. Is that right?
Yes.
And he used to talk about somebody used to sneak in his room and get his money. Do you know who that would have been?
Probably me.
Do you still do that?
No.
Okay.
I don't know where he keeps
his money. Well, I think he keeps some investments now.
Yeah, probably.
Okay. Now we get to talk to the graduate here. Mike, what are you getting ready to graduate with?
My master's in sport administration in August.
Awesome. So now, would you just like to share something about your family?
I'm thankful for them for always being there for me, supporting me, loving me, and being there for anything that I happen to need. And I'm thankful for Levy and everything she's done for me, my grandma and mom for basically being there when I need them, and be there for any time they need me. And I love them and support them and thankful for them. And like Olivia said, I do save my money, but she cannot find it because it's in my bank.
Awesome. All right, Sister Connie, we are right now going to share some things. Mike, get ready.
Go ahead and mute that, Terry. All right, Mike, come up here now. Mike has graduated twice, So he doesn't need a Bible this time, but he's got a special devotion in here. And since these guys like something else, this is from the church, he got a coffee mug in here for them. So why don't you give him a congratulations. And again, graduating with a master's degree, what an awesome thing it is. And as Mama said, well, we're afraid you might jinx it. Well, we don't believe in jinxes anyhow, do we? We know that God gives us favor, so he's going to finish that up. And then what we do know is when he makes all that money, what are you going to do with it first, Mike? You're going to tithe on it, right? All right, we'll make sure that's where the blessing comes from. You make all the money you want when you tithe.
And then give my mom a dollar.
And then give his mom a dollar. There you go. All right. As Michael's doing double duty and everything, I'm going to give him a chance to get out and get back here. Tanya Beth, come up here. I didn't get to be in this video because I was videoing it, so, you know. She don't have a shortage of words and stuff.
And we're doing this video event today to celebrate her graduation from college, from Arkansas State University, with her bachelor's degree in communications disorders. She will be going to graduate school, and she'll tell you more about that in just a second. Her dad and I, he's doing the video. We are very proud of her. She is our baby. We have two older sons. For those of you who don't know, Kyle and Josh, who are not here with me today, but we're proud of you as well. She is our last one, so we're almost empty nesters, and we're very proud of Katie Beth and her accomplishments. She graduated, am I saying it right, magna cum laude, so she had a high GPA, and we're very, very proud of her. I sat down a while ago and tried to write down some characteristics that I feel like describe Katie Beth. And I'm kind of weird. I do things like I love acrostics. So I took her name, Katie Beth, and I wrote down, she's giggling, she's like, Mom, really? This is my time, my part of the video, so I can do what I want to. I wrote down words that I felt like describe Katie Beth using the first letter of her name. So K, I think she's kind. A, I think she's awesome. Of course, I know all moms saying their kids are awesome, but I think she's awesome. T, she's tender-hearted. She is that for me. I, she's intelligent. A, she's very encouraging. B, she's brave. E, she's kind of extra sometimes. Y'all know what I mean by extra. T, she's talented. And H, she's happy. She's always been happy. She was a happy baby. She was a happy child. She's a happy adult. And she's always brought much happiness into our home.
Hi, I'm Katie Beth Tanky. I just graduated with my Bachelor's of Science in Communication Disorders. For those of you that don't know what that is, it's basically an undergraduate degree that prepares us one step closer to becoming a speech therapist. What's a speech therapist? They do more than just teach you how to talk. Many of you have had loved ones that suffered from a stroke, and a speech therapist was probably there to teach them how to eat again, how to talk again. Speech therapists also help children as young as babies with their feeding if they have trouble eating in the NICU. They also help children when they're in preschool if they can't say their K's or other sounds, other words that they just can't say quite right. So it's a broad range of possibilities for me. I love children, I love everybody, so I'm excited to get to work with whatever population that the Lord leads me to do. I'm very excited I'll be attending graduate school at Arkansas State University for speech therapy. And that will begin this summer, and I should graduate with my master's degree next December of 2022. And I'm very excited and thankful for everybody's kindness and support over the years while I've been on this journey. It's been difficult, but it's been worth it, and I'm so excited to see where I will go and what all will unfold in my life. Thank you so much.
And we are very proud of her. I'm proud of her as a father, but also as her pastor, I'm proud of her. And so, give her a hand clap. All right. We are proud of each one of these graduates. It is an accomplishment always to be able to graduate, especially in a COVID year of education, that these kids had to do things in such a different way. They got interrupted last March in high school, in college, and they worked their way through some very challenging times. So I think you ought to give all graduates all over this country a big hand. I want to get into Word. I thought about graduation. I thought about young people. I thought one of the biggest things that they deal with a lot of times is fear. Fear of what they're getting ready to do, fear of where they're going to go in life, fear of what's going to happen in the future, and we all deal with that. But I want to talk to you for a few moments this morning about living a fearless life. In Matthew chapter 25, I'm not going to read the passage to you. Most of you are very familiar with Matthew 25. Matthew 25, we find the story of the man who went away and he left the talents with people. He left three sets of talents. He left five, he left two, and he left one to three different guys. And we know that story. We love that story. It's a great story to talk about, and because he left all his money and what they should do with it, and it was their choice of what they did with it. And two of the guys, two-thirds of them, they did what they were supposed to. They took what they were given, and they used it to grow it. But one of them didn't. And the primary reason the third guy didn't, we find in Scripture, is because of fear. Because of the fear he had in his life, he chose not to use his talents in life. Robert Louis Stevenson said, "Keep your fears to yourself, but share your courage with others." Everybody faces fear. You know what fear is? Fear is simply a feeling of dread, alarm, panic, and anxiety. And over the last year, we've seen that in so many ways. We've seen that manifested in many different ways in most people's lives. Different kind of fears take place all over our nation and the world. And we are living in a time filled with fear. Fear ranges from mild anxiety and panic attacks in some people, and it's very real. Fear is a learned response. Did you know you're not born afraid? Babies aren't born afraid. They become afraid. They get afraid, and a lot of times it's something that they learn. And so if it's learned, it's something that needs to be unlearned. It's something that we need to take out of our life. In 2 Corinthians 10, he says, "Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." You know, that's one of the things we have to do, is we're going to have to bring our thoughts into captivity. And we're going to have to eliminate the fears. Nobody can eliminate fear in your life but you. God's not going to take fear out of your life. He requires us to do that. He'll give us faith. He'll give us strength. But he's going to require us to do something with the fear in our life, because he's not going to just automatically remove it. You're going to have to do something with it. He's left things for you in this life, and you may be afraid to do it, and may be afraid to use those things that he's left for you. And it's something that you're going to be challenged with. Now think of these young people. Michael could have been fearful that when he went off to U of A a few years ago, that, "Oh, I can't do that." Well, he showed that he could do it. And so, and now he's working on something else. Katie Beth, she's graduated college, and now she's got to, and on June 1st, she's got to go straight back in to 19 more months of it. And the fear is, there's all kinds of fear surrounding that. When Christian graduated high school yesterday, now the thought is going to be, what am I going to do in my future? What am I going to be? What am I going to become? And you can sit there and waddle in those things, or you can say, you know what? I'm going to go past my fear and do something in life. I'm going to do something for God, and I'm going to do something for my family. I'm going to do something for me, and I'm going to grow in my life. But you see, fear comes in so many different forms. It comes and attacks us in many different forms. One of the main forms that comes in fear in your life is fear of the past. Everybody here has a past. We all have a past. And there are things in everybody's past that nobody wants anybody to know about, right? Sure, you have things in your past. I mean, none of us are perfect people, so everybody has a past and has something that may be ugly in our past. And we all carry something from our past that we don't want anyone else to see. Some people fear success. They're afraid if they succeed, then more's going to be expected from them. Or they fear failure. Because everybody thinks, well, what if I fail? Well, we're going to understand a little bit more about that in a few moments. Or rejection. I remember growing up when I was in high school, one of my fears, and I feared asking girls on dates, because if I didn't ask them, they couldn't reject me. They couldn't. So I didn't go. I didn't go to prom. I didn't go to homecoming. I didn't go to any of those things because of fear. And finally, I'm pulled up to McDonald's one day in 1988, and I saw a girl in the McDonald's drive-thru, and I said, "Man, I'm gonna tell you what. She knocked me out when I saw her. When she said, 'Do you want any fries with that?'" I said, "Yeah, I do want some fries with that milkshake and that cheddar melt. I want some fries with that thing." And so, I mean, I came in there and went to McDonald's. And I looked, my cousin was with me. I looked at my cousin. I said, "Guess what?" I said, "That's going to be my wife one day." My cousin laughed. She said, "You got to meet her first. You're too big a chicken." And I was. Because I was afraid if I would ever talk to her, she'd tell me no. And she probably would have because of the fear. But finally, we finally met a couple of months later. We met in college, and then we became friends. But it wasn't enough for me just to be her friend. You know, so there was a fear, I'm going to ask her out. And what if she told me no? Well, you know what? Guess what? I was staying home by myself anyway. And so I wasn't going to be any worse off if she told me no. And so finally, I went up and I asked her. I said, "Hey, do you want to go out on a date?" I'd never taken a girl on a date. I didn't even know where to take her. But I took her out on a date, I took her to a basketball game. Now the rest is history. We've been married 30 plus years now. We've been together since 1988. And so you understand, there was a fear that I had to get past, and I feared that rejection. Everybody has those fears. Sometimes we fear the future. We fear death. We fear all these things, and they are real fears. But you have to decide if you're going to overcome it. One thing I have learned in life, I'm not afraid to try something for fear of failure, because guess what? I've failed plenty of times in my life, but no failure I've ever had has been final. And so I can learn to live without it. Because when you have fear operating in your life, it produces negative consequences in you. It's going to produce negative things in you, because fear will paralyze your decision making. It immobilizes your action. It hinders your prayer. It limits your faith. It restricts relationships. It lowers productivity. It jeopardizes health. And it stifles joy in your life. Now, do you want that? Or do you want to have joy in your life? Do you want to have health? Do you want to have faith? You say, "I want to walk in faith and health and joy. So I have to get past my fears and overcome those things. I don't let those negative consequences push me down and hold me down." Because God's given us a future. You know, fear came in this world when Adam and Eve sinned. What did they do? Well, they sinned and they knew they were wrong, right? So because of the fear that they had in them, what did they go? Hide themselves from God. God found them anyway, didn't he? God saw it when they first sinned. It didn't catch him off guard. And fear was the distance between God and man. It wasn't just rebellion. It was the fear that became the distance between God and man. Jesus described the debilitating power of fear in these parable of talents. It is a story about being good stewards of God, of all that God has entrusted with us, but we have a choice. Am I going to be a good steward, or am I going to be a fearful steward? Am I going to be somebody that doesn't take care of what God has given me? Because here's what fear will do. If we look in this passage, fear gives us several things. Fear causes confusion. Everybody say confusion. Man, we live in a world filled with confusion. And we're filled with confusion because of fear. And it's because of that. Look at what the Bible says in Matthew 25, verse 18. It talks about that man went off with the attitude of the master and the other two men who made investments. The master went on his journey, and the first two men went at once. They're given their talents, and they went at once and did something with it. But they set out with a purpose, but the third man was confused. And what happened is he got confused in his own fears and let confusion confuse him. And he didn't go at once. He just stayed back and said, "You know what, I'm not going to do anything because I'm afraid that I'm not going to be able to accomplish what I'm supposed to accomplish." And you know what we have to learn to do? And this is what we have to learn to do with God. We have to learn to do in our life. We have to learn to go on. Everybody say, "Go on." We have to learn to go on. We must go on with what we have regardless of the challenges and the opportunities. You're going to have obstacles. You're going to have challenges. But you have to go on with your life. You can either just, you can put yourself in a box and you can hide away, or you can go on and say, you know what, I'm going to go on with God and I'm going to serve Him. I'm going to do the best I can. I'm going to take a chance. I'm not talking about gambling, folks. I'm talking about taking a chance in your life to do something bigger than you've ever done. Do something greater than you've ever done. Stepping out on faith, and that's stepping away from fear. But you see, confusion will cause us not to do those things. Perhaps this guy was intimidated because he was only given one talent while the others were given more. Maybe he was jealous. I don't know. Not sure what it was. Maybe he thought the master didn't have confidence in him. I'm not sure. But understand this. Probably those feelings of inadequacy were not because the master felt that way about him, but those were fears that he had in himself. That the intimidation was his own. The fear of inadequacy was his own. Here's what you need to understand. Everybody needs to get this, because this will cause you fear and confusion. Don't compare yourself with others. Amen. Just because somebody has more or somebody has less, don't compare yourself with others. And I can go back and I can tell myself something as a young person, not to compare myself with others. Don't compare yourself with the person who's valedictorian. Don't compare yourself with the person who is last in their class. Don't compare yourself with the person who's always excelling, or the person who may think that they're doing mediocre. You know what? Because we're all different, and we all have special plans by God in our lives. And don't compare. Churches shouldn't compare themselves. Because we're all different, and we're not supposed to compare ourselves with other people. Don't compare yourself with anybody else. Go on in your life. We need to practice what those first two did. Everybody needs to go at once to serve God in their life. The key phrase was at once. What happened is, if you wait when God gives you a blessing, if you wait when God puts a talent in your life, if you wait to do something with it, fear will cripple you, because if you don't go at once and do it, you may lose it. Another thing fear does is it breeds complacency. Fear makes us dig a hole and hide what we need to put to work. Here's an important life lesson about money. Now, everybody likes to talk about money. Mike, you're going to like this, okay? Mike is always talking about investing and so forth. Has anybody here ever heard of the rule of 72? The rule of 72 is an investment term, and like investing money. Baron Rothschild, the great financier, described compound interest as the eighth wonder of the world. The first step in saving money is stop losing it by paying interest. Think about it. Consider the rule of 72. Here's the formula. The number 72 divided by the compound rate of return equals the number of year money doubles. For example, at 6% return, it would double in 12 years. At 8%, it would double in 9 years. And at 10%, it would double in 7.2 years. This is the rule of 72. So some people are afraid to invest. Many years ago, my dad, before Nucor opened, my dad had he'd been selling cars, and he kept all his commissions, Brother Bubba. He kept them in his pocket. And this was in 1987, and my dad had $12,000 worth of commissions in his pocket. And I said, Dad, you need to invest that. And I said, and I told him, I was a freshman in college, and I said, Dad, you need to invest that. And I said, you know, they're opening a Nucor plant here. And I looked at it. I remember at that time, the stock for Nucor was $35 a share. I said, you ought to take some of that and buy Nucor stock. And my dad, who is a farmer and a car salesman, said, oh, that's gambling to buy stock in them. And I said, Dad, just take half of it and do that. It's in your pocket. $12,000 he had in his pocket. How many people carry $12,000 in their pocket? He didn't want to put it in the bank. He wanted to carry it around. And I said, Dad, you got to do something with this. He said, it's gambling. He didn't go buy any stock in Nucor. $35 a share. When they ran their first beam of steel the next year, their stock went from $35 to $105 a share. If he would have just taken half of that and put it in there and let it continue to, as it continued to split and over the years, that $6,000 would have become hundreds of thousands of dollars. But you know what he did? He didn't do it because he was afraid. And he never had that. You don't have to become wealthy, but he let fear cripple him because that was gambling. But yet he was investing in the farm. Come on now. If you're going to invest in your life. And invest your life. God has given everybody here talents and resources. But fear will make you dig a hole with the talents and resources in your life. It's time to dig up your talents, your gifts, your dreams, your goals, your hobbies, your plans, and invest in others. Not just in yourself, but invest in others. What do? You mentor and teach somebody. Many of you have so many gifts that you could put in somebody else's life. And that you can pour into a young person, pour into somebody with less experience in their life, and you can help them. I'm going to hurry. Fear makes you cynical. Boy, cynicism is at an all-time high right now in our country and in our world. What did fear do? Fear gave this man a negative attitude. What did he say? The first thing out of his mouth, he says, you know what? I knew he was a hard man. I mean, that's what that third guy said. I knew he was a hard man. He became cynical. The other two never saw the master that way. They didn't see him as a hard man. They saw him as somebody that had invested in them. And that the master invested in them. And so what they did, they went and did something with it. But this guy saw the master and said, oh, he's not investing in me. He's a hard man. He's hard to work for. Guess what? Some of the greatest people in your life are hard to work for. But it's not supposed to be easy, is it? Life isn't supposed to always be easy. Sometimes we have to go through those hard things and those people and not be cynical about it. You know, these two guys were positive about their relationship with the master. And the other guy was negative. Don't be negative about your relationship with God. Well, you know, God's blessed somebody else. He didn't bless me. God has blessed you more than you could ever imagine. Don't be jealous if somebody else has more stuff or has more money or has a bigger house or a bigger car or a better job than you do. Don't compare yourself to them. And don't be jealous of somebody. Know that God has great plans for your life. I don't care how old you are or how young you are. God has great things for you. And it's up to you to go and get those things. And being cynical and negative will not help you at all. In fact, when we look at this parable, we find the master was very appreciative of the guys who did something for him, wasn't he? He wasn't a hard man. He was a man that was appreciative and generous toward those others. And they shared in his happiness. This other guy was just fearful, and it made him cynical. Another thing that fear does, fear makes us cop out. Fear is a big cop out, isn't it? What do we have to do? We have to learn to get excuses out of our vocabulary. Everybody say excuses. You know, it's time for the church and the people of God to get rid of their excuses. We don't have an excuse. We can't blame. We don't need to blame things on the government. We don't need to blame things on society. We don't need to do that. We've got to get rid of the excuses and do things for God. Excuses keep us from being productive. He blamed the character and personality of the master as the cause of his lack of investing. But he had the choice to invest anyhow. Well, let's go ahead and blame God. Well, God's the reason our country's in the shape. No, it's not. No, he's not. That's not the reason for that. A great deal of fear. You know, fear, this is what fear will do. Fear will have that person say, I didn't do that. If you've ever raised more than one kid, you'll know that one of them is always going to have an excuse. I didn't do that. Somebody else did it. When my mom had my older two brothers, she had my older two brothers, and my oldest brother always blamed everything on my middle brother. Billy would say, Richie did it. Richie did it. Richie did it because my middle brother could not, he could not defend himself because he couldn't talk. So my brother always blamed somebody else. When my brother Richie began to speak, the very first thing that he said was, Billy did it. After all those years of have been blamed for those things, you see, the cop-out, it's transferable, isn't it? It has denial, alibis, blaming others. Or even cop out saying, it wasn't so bad. Or we'll have this guilt, yes, but, that kind of attitude. And it really wasn't me. It's my mood or my personality or my temper. Or like to say, it's not my fault. That's what happens when people cop out. Or they say this, probably the worst cop out of all is this: I can't do it. So they're just not going to try it because I can't do it. We sell ourselves short so many times. So many times. I'm not a carpenter. I'm not an electrician. I'm not a plumber. But I made a decision that there are certain things I would have to learn to do to help myself out or even help the church out. And now, thanks to different things, thanks to other people showing me or YouTube or even different things like that, I've been able to do it. I've never changed a breaker before. But over the last couple of weeks, I've gone over to my son's house and changed breakers in his house. Why? Because he didn't need to get an electrician. You know what I learned? I can learn how to do something if I try. Instead of saying I can't do it, I've learned that you can do things. And there's simple things like that in our life. If God is for us, who can be against us? So if we also live by the philosophy, guess what? I can do all things through Christ who gives us strength, then we don't have to walk in fear. Finally, fear does this. Fear will cost you your potential. Now look at this, Christian, I see you. There's a lot of potential in you. Katie Beth, Michael Allen, there's a lot of potential. Don't let fear cost you your potential for your future. There is a price tag attached to fear. What doesn't develop deteriorates. And fear, if you stop developing, you will deteriorate in your life. In the end, this guy loses his complete investment. He took it because of fear. He didn't use it. It was taken from him. Folks, if you don't use what you've been given by God, you will deteriorate. Your potential will move. Think about it. If you were to bury money in the backyard to give to your children and grandchildren, it would continue to be worth less as time passes. Did you know your money decreases in value? Why does money decrease in value? Because of inflation, right? $100 today is not the same as $100 was in 1988. Think of the different things. In fact, $100 today is not the same as it was last year. Go try and buy some wood right now. Price of wood has gone up, hasn't it? In just the last year, it's gone up. Or how about this? $100 worth of gas last year compared to $100 worth of gas today. How much does that put in your tank? That's called inflation, right? So if you bury your money in the backyard and you're going to leave it to your kids are going to get less than what you planned for them to get. It's just a simple truth. And all that's because of fear. Now, none of you are going to bury your money in the backyard, are you? You're not foolish. You're not going to do that. You're going to put it in investments or in banking or something like that just even to earn some simple interest. It's the same in life. We can't bury ourselves in the backyard, folks. We can't do that. Come to music, please. Fear will diminish you. But oh, hear me. Hear this preacher this morning. Faith will enrich you. It will enrich you. Jesus said in John chapter 14, "Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father." Because of what he has done, he says, "You will do greater things than these." Now, this is to me one of the most powerful verses in all the Bible. Especially when you go to the back of this particular book, this particular John, in chapter 21, he says, by the end of that book, he says that there's not enough paper to contain all the works that Jesus did, but yet Jesus said, greater than these you will do. There's not enough books to contain all that Jesus did, but greater than these you will do. So I want you to think about the potential in your life. I don't care if you're old or if you're young. If you're still breathing, you have potential. You can be a blessing. You can be used by God. If you buried your investments with fear, go and dig them up today. Go and dig up your hope. Go and dig up your faith. Go and dig up the goodness of God in your life. And make an investment for the will of God in your life, because God has a will for everybody. One day you're going to face a Savior, and you're going to have two things that He's going to say. You're either going to face Him and He's going to look at you and He's going to say, "Well done," or He's going to say, "Depart from me." What do you want Him to say about you? When you're at the end of the line, when you're standing before the Savior, what do you want Him to say? "Well done," or "Depart"? If you want Him to say "Well done," you've got to eliminate the fear in your life. "I'm not going to walk in fear." Everybody faces them. Everybody has doubts. But you don't have to walk in those. We don't have to walk in those fears and doubts anymore in our life. Guess what? You can live a fearless life. You can walk by faith and not by sight. Because that's what God's called us to do. I want to ask you to stand to your feet. I want everybody to shut your eyes for just a moment. Fear is crippling. I want to ask everybody before we pray, I want to ask everybody, I want you to think right now in your life, I want you to be honest, say, "Pastor, I do wrestle with some fears. I wrestle with fears for my future. I wrestle with fears for my family. I've been fearful about things for my family, about the future of my family, how it's going to work out. I really need prayer about this, because it seems like every day I got anxiety about it. I've got fear about this thing, and it's really tough. I've got fear about my job and about the future that I'm going to have in my job. I need help." If you say, "Hey, I'm dealing with some fears in my life," I want you to lift up your hand. Hold it up. Be honest. Hold it up. Be honest. Don't be afraid. Are you ready to say, "You know what? I want to step out of my fear and I want to walk by faith. I'm not going to have fear over my family anymore." I just want to say something to somebody right now. Listen to me. Maybe you're watching it online, or maybe you're right in here. But the Lord's speaking to me and wanting me to tell this to somebody. I don't know who it is. It says, "You're afraid to step out and try a new job. You're satisfied in the old job, or you're unsatisfied in it, but the new job, you're afraid. You're afraid you're going to be rejected. And I'm telling you today, you need to step out and try it." Did you hear me? I don't know who it is, but God wants somebody to know that don't be afraid to go on that interview. Don't be afraid to go and try that. You're not going to be worse off by trying it. You're not going to be worse off by trying it. Don't fear that rejection. I don't know who it is, but God wants somebody to know that right now. And you may be watching, it may be in here. But don't you be afraid to do that. It's concerning your job. And it may be at your job, going for a promotion or whatever. And I've never spoken anything like this from the pulpit, but I feel so compelled to let somebody know that in the name of Jesus right now. Your future is not set in where you are. You've got to step out and do something for Him. Those of you that raised your hand just a moment ago and said, "Pastor, I'm dealing with fear," I want you to come and stand this altar. Don't be afraid to come. You know what? That's one of the greatest things that cripples us when it comes to spiritual things, and we're afraid to come and declare it because somebody's going to think something's wrong with us. I'm going to stand here in front of you, and I've got lots of things wrong with me, and I'm not afraid to say it. I'm like Apostle Paul. I'm the chiefest of sinners. I'm one of the worst people in this world. But thanks be to God, His salvation changes me. We can break fear out of our life and out of our family, whatever it may be, and we don't have to walk in it anymore. You can have Him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." I want each of you graduates to come up here and stand. You're going into new areas in your life. I don't want you to be afraid. We want to pray for you. We want to know that God's going to help you. How many of you believe God's going to help them? God's going to help them in their future. Heavenly Father, as we get into this time of prayer, I pray Your blessing on each and every one, dear God. Lord, those that are watching online, those, dear God, who are in this house, dear God, that we get a chance to speak life into them, to speak fear out of them, dear God. We declare it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we declare it. Amen and amen. Would you begin right now to pray and to seek God?